Welcome to the Unusual Changemakers podcast. I'm your host, Mary Woods, founder of the medicinal clothing company Seam Siren. My goal is to provide you with access to interviews with inspirational people I've met throughout my entrepreneurial journey who are leading by example in their individual industries. These people inspire me because of the way they are creating healing in the world by helping individuals or the environment through offering their unique gifts to the world with passion, integrity, and humility. Today we're talking to Andrea Plell, co-founder of the Sustainable Fashion Alliance and freelance sustainable fashion consultant. I love Andrea, and when we met, I felt an instant kindred connection, and I hope she feels the same way. Her spirit of collaboration and willingness to share her resources and the information that she holds is really something that I haven't come across with a lot of people. She also has an extremely positive attitude and passion to help sustainable fashion brands thrive. As we talk about a rising tide floats all boats, and we both share that mentality, which I really appreciate. I hope you enjoy our interview and her story. I'm here in my car with Andrea, and I think in my head how to say your last name, Plell. Andrea Plell. And okay. Andrea, can you tell me what you do, what your organization is?
I am it took a while to become this. I'm a sustainable fashion consultant, which a lot of people are like, cool, what does that mean? So my journey kind of started totally not in fashion at all. I was going to school for marketing at San Diego State University, and I was doing the whole kind of working full-time at a corporate job and going to school and trying to make my way through college and doing, you know, what you're kind of told to do in a capitalist country. Go get that great job and make a lot of money and sell people things that they don't really need. So I was feeling inside a lot of ethical conflicts with the path that I was on, and I felt like I didn't have a lot of creative space to make art or express myself, and as someone who's really relied on that in the past and through drawing, through writing, through music, I was feeling this drought of creativity at the time. I'd come home every day and just feel really depressed because my professors were basically teaching us how to take advantage of people. And I would come home and cry, and I knew that I didn't want to use these skills for that. So I felt like I was kind of in the belly of the beast, and I wanted to do good with some of the things that I was learning on the other side. So for one thing, it did teach me how to really filter advertisements and magazines and these images of unattainable beauty. So on the side of going to school, I started working with local designers. I had met a woman in San Diego who was doing all these fashion shows just at random bars around the city, and it was fun. And she has this really cool name. She would go by Maystar, and she was kind of like a local celebrity. And I met her through another friend, and she was like, oh, do you want to model for one of my shows? And I was like, oh, cool, all right, I'll do it. So I started doing that for a while, and I became one of her regular models. And it was all very independent designers, most of which who were using upcycled materials. So materials that were either in warehouses on big rolls that had been there since the 70s, or in some cases, these designers were going to the outlets at Goodwill and finding scrap materials and piecing them together and making interesting garments.
Had you always been into fashion, or is this kind of the first time that you were exposed to fashion and got excited about it?
That was really the first time that I was exposed to it and got excited about it. I think the closest interest to fashion that I had was when I was a teenager. I grew up with three other siblings, and we'd moved to Spokane because California was getting really hard to afford for my parents. So we moved to Spokane, got a big house, like a four-level house, which at the time was super affordable in the 90s. And so I was in the basement at a time when I was about 13, 14 years old. and I got to decorate the walls. And so I'd get these magazines, and some of the ads, I really loved the composition of the ads. And so I would put them on my walls. But as far as like dressing, as far as knowing, you know, how to style things, I was never savvy at that until later in my life. So it's kind of funny that I was like thrown into fashion, literally. And so it was really through these experiences of meeting designers that they would introduce me to their friends. And so instead of just doing these small runway shows at local clubs and local bars, it became, you know, I was modeling for a designer in LA. And then I was also getting called upon from a lot of photographers to do different photo shoots. And so I was like, wow, this is really cool, because yes, I hate my life at school right now, but these extracurricular activities are really allowing the creative juices to flow, because I started, instead of just modeling, I started being like, hey, can we try this? Or I have this outfit in mind, or I started conceptualizing things. And so that really gave me this newfound love for fashion photography, and for fashion illustration. So from there, it was interesting, because the whole upcycled conversation really brought me to, okay, why are people not just buying fabrics? I really didn't know how garments were constructed, what materials were which. I was very much like an H&M Forever 21 shopper at the time. I was in my very early 20s, just becoming an adult in the world and living on my own. And moving back to California, I was like, okay, I need to have, you know, so many shoes, and I need to fit in here. I need to look cute and be stylish and on trend. And all of that kind of came crashing down once I started realizing how toxic the fashion industry really was. And it was just through my personal research on, you know, being triggered by the upcycling. Why are people upcycling? Oh, because there's a big textile waste problem. I think it's like the US accumulates 10.5 million tons of waste, textile waste, to landfill each year. And so I was like, wow, I can't even imagine how much that is. That's intense. That's amazing. And so I started digging a little bit deeper, like, oh, there's problems with, you know, children are picking cotton in other countries that are riddled with pesticides. Okay, that's a problem. Oh, wow, the industry has 8,000 synthetic chemicals at its grasp at any time. All these finishes that are going on clothing, like wrinkle-free, and what are some other ones? Like waterproof, the formaldehyde that they're putting in boxes to ship to the U.S. And the majority of our clothing is being made in India, China, Bangladesh, Cambodia, other countries where it's hard to get full transparency, because a lot of the companies here, you know, are sending their production to other countries to save money, and they're not on site as much as they should be. And so they're missing opportunities to see where, you know, there might be some human rights violations with the workers that are working on clothing. That, you know, they're in some of these countries, the labor rights and the unions are not there. So they're 80% of the people who make our clothes are women and women of color. And in a lot of cases, they're under patriarchal systems that don't allow them to fight back. Yeah. And so in our obsession with fast fashion and with supporting large companies who are outsourcing their production, not in a responsible way, we are, you know, feeling empowered by clothing that's basically, you know, disempowering another woman elsewhere.
That's terrible. So is that what you would say your why is? I always ask this question to people because there's a TED talk by a guy named Simon Sinek, and he always asks, what's your why? Like, why are you doing what you're doing? And would you say it's because of these ethical questions? Is it more, I mean, I'm sure it's all of the things that you've been talking about, but if you could distill it down to like, what's like
the passion or the most fiery thing that gives you the motivation to get up and do this work every day?
Yeah, I think it's really hard to decide what the one thing is. I think that there has to be intense systemic change in the fashion industry, yeah, because we're relying on a system that's still in place from like the 19th century and hasn't had much innovation. And what a lot of people don't realize is that clothing has to be made by human hands in some of the processes. It doesn't just come straight out of a machine. So for me, particularly, some of the passion points for me is, yes, definitely the social aspect of just the abuses that garment workers are going through. Also, I'm very passionate about the use of natural materials and regenerative materials, because if you think about it, the most popular fabric that's used in clothing is polyester, which is it relies on fossil fuels, and it's essentially like wearing plastic on your body. So there's not only, you know, hazardous health issues that can come from that, from it suffocating your ability to detox and to sweat out toxins, and it also messes with your endocrine system. It also, unlike natural materials that let your body breathe or allow your body to breathe, it's hard to biodegrade. Like, it takes hundreds of years, whereas natural material will actually be compostable within your lifetime.
I take walks on the beach a lot, and I was in the Sonoma County Coastal Park, and I just saw, like, the thing that I see the most, especially in Hawaii as well, are the waistbands, like the waistbands from underwear, mm-hmm, or from like the, like, it's just, it's really, I'm like, this does not belong here. I want to start like an Instagram account that, like, things that do not belong on the beach.
But I love that.
Yeah. So what trends are happening right now in the industry that you feel like needs improvement, mm-hmm, that could help tip the needle to help the industry really evolve in a really meaningful way?
Yeah, one of the things that I think is kind of lacking are really being able to measure sustainability. You have all these brands that are coming out and saying, oh, I'm a sustainable brand because I use leather that's a byproduct of the meat industry. Okay, well, you know, how sustainable is that really? And what other things are you doing within your business model to, you know, potentially make it circular model? Or how many emissions are happening? How much carbon emissions are happening within your company? Is it better if you weren't a company? Would that help with our carbon emissions? You know, like, if you didn't exist, like, what is really making you stand out as sustainable and helpful in this situation? Yeah. So there is a thing called the HIG Index, which was produced by the Sustainable Apparel Coalition. And I think that that's, you know, phase one of this conversation. I think it's great because it helps big companies gauge their sustainability, where they stand, what they need to work on. I think a lot of the members that are within this conversation, though, are large companies like Walmart, H&M, and that kind of makes me nervous, because I don't think a large company should really lead these conversations, because
their
interest is in the interest of the stakeholders and the investors. So I think that there really needs to be a coming together, or maybe even like cooperatives, alliances, where smaller, medium-sized brands, or, you know, really intentful, mindful angel investors to come in and create something that's more substantial as far as measuring the environmental emissions, the social aspects, everything, to give like an actual grading to these, mm-hmm, companies. Because right now we're relying mostly on certifications, which is a whole other story, because the people who own this, who are giving out these certifications, it's not very accessible to a smaller, medium-sized sustainable brand or farmer in that case. Like, there's a lot of, same with food, there's some cotton farmers that aren't certified organic, but they're still growing organic because they have to jump through hoops to try to get the certification, and they have to get, you know, take out loans to get this certification. So, and that's a problem because, you know, you're having to really rely on your own research a lot of times to dig in here. And a lot of people don't have time for that. So it becomes very confusing.
Yeah. And I also feel like there's not, once somebody gets a certification, like a point that I make too is like, I don't feel like there's people that are actually going and like doing checks and balances. Like, okay, you got the certification. And so there's somebody that's going to come out to your farm or come out to and make sure that you're still adhering to the criteria that would give you this certification. So it's mm-hmm. like, it's kind of like a one and done. And then there isn't really follow up after that. So mm-hmm. I feel like for bigger companies that can pay to like get everything to look good for the certification, and then yeah. things kind of fall away afterwards. And that I feel like that's their credibility is a really big issue.
Exactly. No, I totally agree.
Well, my final question on that note, my final question is about plants. So as you know, I'm a big plant fanatic, and mostly around materials and dyes and that kind of thing. But I also just like to hear how plants are interfacing with individuals' lives, and just to bring awareness around all the different ways that we're in contact with plants. So for you, how do you incorporate plants into your life, if at all?
I will say I'm not the best plant keeper. I'm really working on it. But I really have, I'm lucky because I live in a home that's just surrounded by beautiful plants. I have 3 redwoods in my yard, and a beautiful oak tree, and also a Japanese maple. Whoever owned the house before my current landlord really, I think, wanted to live in Marin, but I'm in the Northeast Bay, so it's like, I feel like I'm in Marin every morning when I come outside. So that it's just lovely looking out of my windows. I also have vines that are just draped along the sides of my home. And then inside my home, I have a beautiful peace lily that's next to my desk. And I initially had gotten it because I wanted, you know, those are kind of plants that cleanse the air and cleanse the space.
Yeah.
I have a lot of succulents surrounding that. So I love just being immersed with the color green. Green is my very favorite color. So it's definitely always a part of my palette when I'm doing any kind of artwork, or if I'm picking the foods that I'm eating are accompanied by some kind of green, like kale or spinach or... Oh, what else? Oh, and then I do have like a daily ritual of taking turmeric in my tea or coffee in the morning. And I do cook a lot, so I often use it in a lot of different recipes as an anti-inflammatory. And it's also really great for your skin too. So sometimes I will give myself a turmeric mask if I'm having, you know, like some acne problems or something's happening on my face that I just need to tone it down. But please don't leave it on your face for very long, because it'll make your face orange. And then another plant that I really love is aloe. I have an aloe plant in my house, and I used to suffer from really bad acne, and now that I'm older, I'm 35 now, so I'm not having as many problems as before. But when I do have a breakout, I generally will do like a tea tree and aloe on my face. Mm. And it works better than anything that I've ever used in my entire life. And if you can imagine someone who had suffered from acne before, tried everything, all the stuff at the you know, like a CVS or whatever, which I don't shop at anymore for these kind of products. But it's funny to learn how to kind of make your own products and then learn that, wow, they work so much better. I didn't have to pay a lot of money for this. It makes you feel really self-sufficient as well. And I think I often have a lot of essential oils in my home on a diffuser that help me feel, you know, a little bit more balanced during the day while I'm working. Oh, and then when I'm feeling a little bit off, I have a dear friend who made me an elderberry elixir last fall that she harvested. She handpicked all of these elderberries. So I have that in my fridge, and I I take a spoonful or I put it in some water, some sparkling water during the day when I'm feeling a little off. So yeah, I love plants. They're a part of my daily life. I want to learn more about plants and I'm really appreciative of all the work that you're doing. It's so fascinating to me.
With the Sustainable Fashion Alliance, then you also do freelance PR work and writing of sorts. Yeah. And your main mission is around giving smaller brands access to your network of people and also helping them grow and coach them in the things that they would need to do to be successful in the industry. Would you add anything to that? And then B, can you give us your contact information about how to reach you and on social media, about how to follow you and also the Sustainable Fashion Alliance? And that would be great. Thank you.
Yeah, definitely. So I've been doing this work for about 10 years. I was kind of tapping into my journey where it went from a blog to a fashion show to me working directly with designers. Oh, and I had a magazine somewhere in there as well where I was getting clothing from sustainable brands to, style them. And I was working with different photographers to do these fashion spreads and also writing. So I kind of unknowingly built a portfolio piece for myself with all of these things. And in doing a large event and having to do all the PR and curating that entirely as just an independent project. So fast forward to a couple years after that, I was actually working directly with different startups and different brands and helping them with their communications, helping them conceptualize different fashion campaigns, also writing for different magazines about sustainability since I kind of got in at a point when it was pretty small and I've seen it grown. So I'm very familiarized with what's gone on in the industry, the different verbiage, how to explain different things and what to note and what to ask different brands to make sure that they're accountable for what they're doing. So the Sustainable Fashion Alliance was really born out of all of my experiences in learning what sustainable brands needed to be sustainable in the marketplace. And so with Sustainable Fashion Alliance was founded by my colleague Joyce Hu, who's a marketing director and creative director for Wildlife Works, and myself. We had put together a big event for Fashion Revolution about 4 years ago, where we did a demonstration through Union Square in San Francisco with some local brands. We dressed up a bunch of models and just walked through major shopping district of San Francisco. We went past H&M, we went into the mall. So it was really fun. And so this was kind of like it was a point when we got to bond and start collaborating. And, you know, this is such our passion is really to help others and to be kind of a conduit and facilitator to connections. And so we have a member, we have a lot of members, and these members are sustainable brands that are either just starting out or in, you know, their third, fourth, fifth year, so small and medium sized, and they're looking for collaboration, they're looking for camaraderie. I mean, this is a really, it's kind of a dark industry, and you need that reinforcement that yes, you're doing something good, keep going at it. Often our members are sharing skill sets because a lot of times they're entrepreneurs, but they're doing a lot of things themselves. So one person might be really good at social media. So we have them speak at our events to our other members and teach them different things. Or someone might really know Facebook marketing really well, or how to track analytics and how to implement different marketing strategies based on those analytics. So we're constantly just trying to empower and find opportunities for small and medium-sized sustainable brands, whether that's with marketing, with communication, social media, or finding opportunities for them with pop-ups and larger collaborations and also mentorship programs with larger companies. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, I was telling you there's a couple of big companies. Koyuchi and Amarver are more on the eco-friendly, sustainable leaders right now in their space. Koyuchi does home goods. They do like organic linens and towels. robes. If you search online, they're pretty much the only thing that's coming up at the moment at the top of the list. And also Anrdrea has really been a leader specifically in the Bay Area for sustainable fashion. So we've been able to connect our members with them as well to do different collaborations, which then gets, you know, the smaller brands on the radar of more people and of that market. And so it's really exciting. And one other thing that I'll say, because I'm trailing on, is that we also do public events. So our next event, we're doing a mending bar in collaboration with Fibershed and CCA, where we are inviting people to bring their clothing. A lot of events that either feature sustainable leaders in the space or innovators through panel discussions and forums that are open to the public. And we also do workshops and activities, such as we are hosting in collaboration with Fibershed and CCA, California College of the Arts, a mending bar this April, where we're asking people to bring their worn or damaged clothes in, and we're going to have five different stations where they can learn boro or sashiko hand mending skills, how to hem pants, how to darn your sweaters or socks, mm-hmm. and also just like an upcycle station for any scraps that we accumulate during the day. So, I mean, we really want to empower consumers. We want to introduce them to these brands that are trying to also empower them and change the industry. And that's really our goal.
Oh, that's awesome. Thank you. Where can we find you? Where can we follow your blog and follow the Sustainable Fashion Alliance?
Please find me at sustainablefashionalliance.com and on social, it's Sustainable Fashion Alliance. It's very, very long, but we're the only ones there, Sustainable Fashion Alliance. And then my personal journey, I keep on mostly on Instagram. My handle is Ecologique Fashion. And I do a lot of freelance communications and PR and event coordination. You can find me at ecologiquefashion.com.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your time today. It's really a pleasure to talk to you and always to see you and catch up. So thank you.
Oh, the pleasure is all mine. Thank you, Mary.
I saw it written and I saw it say,